അഗോറ സെമിനാർ പരമ്പരയിൽ ഇന്ന് നടക്കും വന്നത് വളരെ വിചിത്രമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു വിഷയത്തെ സംബന്ധിച്ചുള്ള വെബിനാറാണ്. ഡോക്ടർ കലേഷ് നമ്മുടെ ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ച് ഈ വെബിനാറിൽ പങ്കുചേരുന്നുണ്ട്. അദ്ദേഹത്തിന്റെ സവിശേഷമായ വ്യക്തിത്വത്തെ കുറിച്ച് ഹരിസാർ സൂചിപ്പിക്കുകയുണ്ടായി. ചിത്രശലഭങ്ങളും ഉറുമ്പുകളുമെല്ലാം ഇൻഡിക്കേറ്റർ സ്പീഷീസാണ്. പ്രകൃതിയിലുണ്ടാകുന്ന ചെറിയ മാറ്റങ്ങളെ പോലും ആദ്യം ബാധിക്കുന്നത് ഈ ചെറുജീവികളെയാണ്. കാലാവസ്ഥാ വ്യതിയാനങ്ങൾ മനുഷ്യനെ ബാധിക്കുന്നതിന് മുൻപ് കണ്ടെത്തി തടയാൻ ഇവയുടെ നിരീക്ഷണം മാത്രം മതി എന്നതാണ്. ഓണത്തുമ്പികൾ ഇവിടെ നിന്നും ആഫ്രിക്ക വരെ സഞ്ചരിക്കുന്നു എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് വിശ്വസിക്കാൻ പറ്റുമോ? ഇന്തോനേഷ്യയിൽ നിന്ന് പലായനം ചെയ്ത് നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിലെത്തിയ ഉറുമ്പുകളുണ്ട്. ചിത്രശലഭങ്ങളെ നോക്കി മഴ പെയ്യുമോ ഇല്ലയോ എന്ന് പ്രവചിക്കാൻ കഴിവുള്ളവരിവിടെയുണ്ട്. രസകരമായ കുറെ സത്യങ്ങളാണ് ഇന്ന് നമ്മൾ ഈ വെബിനാറിലൂടെ മനസ്സിലാക്കാൻ പോകുന്നത്. ജർമ്മൻ ശാസ്ത്രജ്ഞനും ചിന്തകനുമായ ഹിബ്രസ് ബിസ്മാർക്കിനോട് ഒരാൾ ചോദിച്ചു, ഏത് രീതിയിലുള്ള ജീവിതമാണ് താങ്കൾ ഇഷ്ടപ്പെടുന്നത്? മറുപടിക്ക് ബിസ്മാർക്കിന് കൂടുതൽ ആലോചിക്കേണ്ടി വന്നില്ല. ഉറുമ്പിന്റെ ജീവിതമാണ് എനിക്കിഷ്ടം. ചെറുതെങ്കിലും നമുക്കൊക്കെ മാതൃകയാക്കാവുന്ന ജീവിയാണ് ഉറുമ്പ്. അധ്വാനശീലരായ ഈ കൊച്ചു ജീവികൾ തങ്ങളുടേതായ ഒരു സാമ്രാജ്യം പടച്ചുണ്ടാക്കി അതിൽ സാമൂഹ്യ ജീവിതം നയിച്ചു വരുന്നു. സമൂഹമായ അല്ലാതെ ഒറ്റയ്ക്ക് ജീവിക്കുന്ന ഒരു ഉറുമ്പിനെ പോലും നമുക്ക് കണ്ടെത്താനാകില്ല. ലോകത്ത് തന്റെ ഭാരത്തെക്കാൾ എത്രയോ മടങ്ങ് ഭാരം ചുമക്കാൻ കഴിവുള്ള ഏക ജീവി ഉറുമ്പ് മാത്രമാണ്. നമ്മുടെ പരിസരങ്ങളിലെല്ലാം നമുക്ക് ഉറുമ്പിനെ കാണാൻ കഴിയും. ലോകത്തിലെ ആവാസയോഗ്യമായ എവിടെയും ഉറുമ്പുകളെ കാണാൻ കഴിയും. ഒരുപക്ഷെ കടന്നലുകളിൽ നിന്നായിരിക്കണം ഉറുമ്പുകൾ രൂപം കൊണ്ടത്. സ്വന്തം സ്രവങ്ങൾ ഉപയോഗിച്ച് ഇലകൾ ഒട്ടിച്ച് കൂടുണ്ടാക്കുന്ന ഉറുമ്പുകളുണ്ട്. മരങ്ങളുടെ ഇലകളിൽ ഉറുമ്പുകളുടെ കൂട് കണ്ടാൽ അതിനർത്ഥം ആ ഭാഗത്തെ കാലാവസ്ഥ സുസ്ഥിരമാണെന്നാണ്. ചെറിയ കാലാവസ്ഥ മാറ്റം പോലും ഉറുമ്പുകളെ സ്വാധീനിക്കും എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. ഒരു വിശേഷമുള്ള ഒരു കാര്യം, തമിഴ്നാട്ടിലെ തൃശ്ശനപ്പള്ളിക്കടുത്ത് എറുമ്പേശ്വരൻ എന്ന ക്ഷേത്രമുണ്ട്. തിരുവരുമ്പൂർ എന്നാണ് സ്ഥലപ്പേര്. അസുരന്മാരെ പേടിച്ച് ദേവന്മാർ ദിവസവും ഉറുമ്പിന്റെ രൂപം കൊണ്ട് ഒരു പാറക്കുന്ന് കയറി അതിന്മേലുള്ള ക്ഷേത്രത്തിൽ ആരാധന നടത്തിയിരുന്നു. ഇതിൽ തൃപ്തനായ ശിവൻ എറുമ്പേശ്വരൻ എന്ന പേര് സ്വീകരിച്ചു എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. അപ്പോ ഉറുമ്പിന്റെ പ്രാചീനതയാണ് അത് വ്യക്തമാക്കുന്നത്. അതുമാത്രമല്ല, ഇന്ന് പരിശുദ്ധ റംസാൻ രാവുകളിലൂടെ കടന്നു പോകുമ്പോൾ നമ്മെ ഓർമ്മിപ്പിക്കുന്ന വിശുദ്ധ ഗ്രന്ഥമാണ് ഖുറാൻ. ഖുറാനിലെ 27-ാം അധ്യായത്തിന്റെ പേര് ഉറുമ്പുകളെന്നാണ്. അങ്ങനെ ഉറുമ്പിന് ഒരുപാട് പ്രശസ്തിയുണ്ട്, പ്രാധാന്യമുണ്ട് എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. അവരുടെ ജീവിതം വളരെ വിചിത്രമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒന്നാണ്. ഒരുപക്ഷെ ബാഹുബലി സിനിമയെ വെല്ലുന്ന തിരക്കഥകളും രാജ്യതന്ത്രങ്ങളും എല്ലാം ഉണ്ട് ഉറുമ്പുകളുടെ സാമ്രാജ്യത്തിൽ. അവർക്ക് നാട്ടുരാജ്യങ്ങളും രാജ്യാതിർത്തികളുമുണ്ട്. ഭക്ഷണത്തിനു വേണ്ടി ഉറുമ്പുകൾ മറ്റ് കോളനികളെ ആക്രമിക്കുകയും ചെയ്യും. ഇതെല്ലാം വെച്ച് നോക്കുമ്പോൾ ഒരു പാരഡൈം, മനുഷ്യ ജീവിതത്തിന്റെ ഒരു പാരഡൈം നമുക്ക് ഉറുമ്പുകളിൽ കാണാം എന്നാണ്. എന്തായാലും ഉറുമ്പ് പിടുത്തക്കാരനായ ഒരു ഡോക്ടറാണ് കലേഷ്, ഉറുമ്പ് പഠിത്തക്കാരനും. അദ്ദേഹത്തെ നമുക്ക് ഈ വെബിനാറുകൾ കിട്ടിയത് ഏറ്റവും സന്തോഷകരമായ കാര്യമായി ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കുകയാണ്. ഇന്നോളം അറിയപ്പെടാത്ത 13-ഓളം പുതിയ സ്പീഷീസുകളെ കണ്ടെത്താൻ ഈ യുവ ഡോക്ടർക്ക് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ട്. കൊല്ലം ശ്രീനാരായണ കോളേജിലെ അഗോറ വെബിനാർ സീരീസിലേക്ക് ഏറെ ബഹുമാനത്തോടെയും സ്നേഹത്തോടെയും ഡോക്ടർ കലേഷ് സദാശിവനെ സ്നേഹപൂർവം ഒരിക്കൽ കൂടി സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ എന്റെ വാക്കുകൾ അവസാനിപ്പിക്കുന്നു.
താങ്ക് യു സുനിൽ സാർ. ഡോക്ടർ കലേഷ് സദാശിവനെ പരിചയപ്പെടുത്തുന്നതിന് വേണ്ടി അഗോറയുടെ ജനറൽ കൺവീനർ ഡോക്ടർ എസ് ജി ഷെട്ടിത്രെ സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു.
Thank you, Hari sir. I am extremely happy to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Kalesh Sadashivan. Dr. Kalesh Sadashivan is a plastic surgeon by profession and a naturalist by passion. He is also a founder member and research associate at Travancore Natural History Society, TNHS, Thiruvananthapuram, an NGO. He is a wildlife photographer and an amateur taxonomist with specific interest in invertebrates. He has discovered and described more than a dozen new species to science from the Western Ghats, including frogs, reptiles, wasps, ants, and odonates. Dr. Kalesh took his MBBS and MS from University of Kerala and is registered with Travancore Cochin Medical Council. Currently, Dr. Kalesh is working in the Plastic and Reconstructive Surgery Department, Government Medical College, Thiruvananthapuram. 2015 onwards, he is a manuscript reviewer for Journal of Threatened Taxa, an international peer-reviewed journal. He was awarded with ICMR Fellowship in 2005 for a research on epidemiology of snake bites. During 2010, he also undertook a status study of broad-tailed grass bird in Ashambu Hills in association with BNHS, IBCN, and TNHS. Again, during 2010-11, he has done a status study of Blandford's laughing thrush in Agastya Malay Hills in association with BNHS, IBCN, and TNHS. He has published 21 peer-reviewed papers on wildlife. Dr. Kalesh has co-authored a book named Urumbugal with K. Manoj, which is published by Kerala Bhasha Institute. Urumbugal is a popular Malayalam book on common ants of Kerala. I have witnessed his enthusiasm in photography while we were together in a team for pelagic bird survey a couple of years back. Dr. Kalesh Sadashivan, a warm welcome to start your session on Agora 2021 webinar series organized by SN College Kollam. Over to Kalesh.
Thank you. So without a formal introduction, let's proceed to the topic. Respect to the popular request, we'll keep the medium as English, and whenever needed, we can have an explanation in Malayalam. I guess people who have doubts can put in the chat box, and finally we'll deal it. So shall we start?
Yes, sir. You can start.
Okay. So today we'll be discussing a short topic. Actually, it's a very short topic on ants, and we are dealing with ants of Kerala. Kerala is a small state in southern India, lying on the western aspect of the Western Ghats. And I'm standing on behalf of Travancore Natural History Society. We have a ant research group called TARG. And me and my colleagues, especially Mr. Manoj, we are doing work on ants of Kerala since last 5-6 years. So let's go into the topic. So this is the first slide, and you can see two ants doing something on the screen. This photograph actually got an award. This is a macro photograph from a place called Aripa in southern Kerala. It's an evergreen forest. And what they are doing is they are passing food. One sister ant is passing food to the other sister called in a process called prophylaxis. It is mouth-to-mouth feeding. So practically, a thing to be happy about ants is that they are all female. It's a female-controlled world. And the males just come during the mating period. It's all a female-dominated world. So basically, my presentation will be dealing with why we study ants. Secondly, the history of ant studies in Kerala, then diversity, and not on the state of the art of knowledge on ants of Kerala, lacuna knowledge gaps, and further gaps on how to bridge them. The origins. As we all know, ants are the most dominant creatures in the terrestrial ecosystem. They evolved from a wasp-like ancestor around 145 or 140 million years ago to 160 million years ago. And at that time, you might be knowing it is the Cretaceous-Jurassic period. And the basic classification is they're coming under class Insecta, Hymenoptera, and family Formicidae. Why are ants so dominant? The basic reason is two. One is that they are social insects. There is division of labor. There is a parental care, the siblings looking after the next generation. And if you consider around 25% of all animal weight on the earth is by ants. You can see on the slide some pictures from Google, basically. You can see the amber with ant inclusions. You can see the position of the earth around 140 million years ago at the Cretaceous period, where the when the dinosaurs also roamed the earth. So why should we study ants? As sir said, basically ants are ecological indicators. So we get a lead time. So all the changes in the environment before affecting us will affect this indicator species. So this means that we'll get a lead time to save ourselves. So basically, it's the way we can save ourselves from destruction. Secondly, they are ubiquitous. They are seen everywhere. There are ant colonies on my table. There are ant colonies in the car. They are everywhere, but people have not studied them. And to everything in the world, in every subject, for in human societies, in whatever science you study, there are parallelisms in the ant world. Turn to the ant ecology. You might think that the single ant you see in the field is an organism, but it's not really like that. You should consider the whole colony as an organism, like a super organism. Everything about the ants, the evolution, the predation, the way they interact, everything happens in the colony level. So that is a super organism. And just like any organism's development, there are three stages in the development of an ant colony. First is the founding stage, then it's followed by the growing stage, and then the reproductive stage. In the founding phase, you can see that the queen, actually the gyne, they comes and lays eggs. And then the first workers come out, and the first worker, you can see on the left side, there's a queen Oikophila, the weaver ant, has laid her first batch of eggs and she's guarding it. Generally, the queens will have wings, but in this case, the wings are absent. The wings are not really absent, they are just dropped off. And she'll be feeding the first batch of workers with the liquefied muscle that comes from her thorax. The first work on the right side, you can see the first worker, which is helping the queen with the parental care. You can see a small egg and a small larva as well. So this is the founding phase. The second phase is the growing phase, where a lot of eggs are laid and they develop and the colony flourishes. And then comes the reproductive phase, when the males come into play. So the big ant you see on the screen is a queen. These are the workers. And the only male element is a small male here. He dies after mating. So it's practically a female-dominated society. So there will be multiple queens who are ready. Actually, gynes. Queens are the leads of the colony, while gynes are the reproductive phase. They are ready to go out and start the new colonies. Come to the ant nest. There are certain ants which nest in the subterranean region inside the soil. There's some of the ants, they create nests or colonies under objects like rocks and logs. These are the terrestrial ants. Some are very partial to trees, lignicolous. They live inside tree holes or under bark and stuff. Some are purely arboreal, which make weaver ant, which make cotton nest or silk nest. And some doesn't have a nest at all. They are temporary nest. Arboreal nest, you can see that they have made a nest using vegetable matter. This species is called Polylacus thrinax. This is a dolichotrus species, which is also a kind of ant which is arboreal. Lignocolous, there are interesting ants. For example, if you see the central slide, there's a small cavity in the tree or the branch where the ants have created a nest. These are myrmecophytes. There are no specific studies on myrmecophytes in India, but then there are certain plant species which certainly depend upon ants for their survival, and they have this kind of spaces where the ants keep their colonies. There are other kind of nests, for example, these catalog species nesting inside the tree bark. Terrestrial nests are simple nests which the ants just keep their brood under some rock or some wood lying on the forest floor. Some ants create subterranean nests, like they go underground. Some ants doesn't have nests at all. This is an example of a constantly moving colony of Leptogenus, or the army ant, very common species in our forest. Come to the feeding. Just like humans, some ants are generalists. They can eat anything. Some are seed harvesters. Some just feed on nectar alone. That can be from the plants or from certain invertebrates like Lysanate caterpillars. Some are just scavengers. They can feed on the waste material. Some are specialized predators. On the slide, you can see a Chromatagus ant, which is rearing scale insects for getting nectar. Some are generalists. You can see a series of ants. They are feeding on tea, which I happened to spill before I went to hospital one day. When I came back, a series of ants were feeding on them. These are ghost ants, and these are really tiny ants, just 1.5 to 2 millimeter in length. They are generalists. They can feed on anything. If you see your home, any tabletop, you'll see them running around. These are otherwise known as the ghost ants, because you can feel them running on your body, but you can't see them. They are really tiny. Some are harvesters, like this mesa species. They harvest the seeds, they dry them and store them just like humans do, like we do farming. This species is feeding on a scale insect. They feed on the nectar from the scale insect. There are certain other species which are just scavengers. They can feed on dead and dead things. Certain ants are predators. They are specialized predators. You can see a small ant feeding on a centipede. This ant is called Stigmatoma or the Dracula ant. We'll come to it later. So there are certain specialized feeders as well. The first slide I showed you, this is prophylaxis, where there is a communication as well as transfer of food between the sisters. So this is a good example of how the resources are transferred within individuals. And how do ants communicate? There are three modes of communication generally. One is a touch. You can see, you might have observed during your childhood days, ants touching each other with their antennae. They are communicating. The second thing is chemical. There are ant trails. During your childhood, you might have interrupted ant trails going on the wall by crossing your finger, rubbing against it. But then there are pheromones or chemical signals which the ants lay. In this picture, you can see a patch of white powdery-like substance. This was taken in Bangalore. And this is actually an ant trail where the chemical from the ant has reacted with the chemicals or minerals on the forest floor, resulting in a white band-like visible ant trail. Generally, this is invisible. Then there is the reason for success, the division of labor. You can see this is a single species, but then if you see the size of the head, this guy's head is really large. This is a small head. These are all same species, but the workers are different morphology. They are of the different caste, just like you have division of labor in humans. One of the ants is interested with finding this. The other ant will be cutting the seeds. The other ant will be taking it to the storage. The other ant will be cutting the seeds into two. One ant will have mouth parts to excavate the carbohydrates from inside this. So there are certain kinds of work which are assigned to certain kinds of castes. So this is one of the reasons why ants are very successful. Then coming to the very significant part, ant plant interactions. You can see a Campanotus species of ant rearing, or rather looking at aphids. This is one of the interesting interactions between ants and aphids. And you can see that they are feeding on the secretions from the aphids. Then coming to other interactions like floral nectar, there are certain ants like this Merinopolis species feeding on the floral nectar. Certain plants have evolved extra floral nectar. These are not actually flowers, but then specialized glands on the plant body where the plant produces certain food packets or nectars which can keep the ant on them. This is actually for protection of the ant from parasites and other stuff. And arthropod interaction is also an interesting feature. A clear case of coevolution. This is a Campanotus ant attending a membrane. So they also feed on the chemicals or the nectar from the membrane segment. So as you see, they evolved 140 million years ago, and we evolved very recently. The animal husbandry has been practiced by ants since very long time, even before we were there on the earth. You can see a weaver ant attending a scale insect. Usually on an interactive class, we would ask the participants to guess what is happening. I'll explain to you. This is actually a Lycaenid caterpillar, an oglu species. It's a butterfly larva, and the red ants are protecting it. In turn, the caterpillar will produce a liquid and the rear end from this dorsal nectal organ where the ant feeds on them and the neurochemistry changes. Instead of protecting the queen, they'll start protecting the caterpillar. Just like we have cows and buffaloes for milk, this ants, they'll be rearing this caterpillar in a specialized nest away from the colony. This is a picture of the Oikophila ant sucking nectar from the gland of the caterpillar. All the pictures in this presentation are taken by either me or Manoj, unless specified. So we have been working on this macro since long time, and this is a result of maybe 2 or 3 months strive for getting this particular picture, because it's a fraction of a second phenomenon where this nectar comes up and the ant just laps it up. This is another species. This is Jamaidus aurea, cerulean caterpillar being attended by the yellow crazy ant, Anaplolepis grasslipper. This is an invasive ant. Another interesting group of arachnids that live along with the ants are called Myrmarachnids. These are spiders. They mimic ants, and then they live alongside ant colonies. What we have observed is that for every ant colony, you will have at least one or two Nurmagana attached to it. So interestingly, this is a group of spiders which has been least studied. So if anybody is interested, they can take it up as a topic and they can actually work on it. And I'm pretty sure that numerous new species are going to be discovered in Nurmagana group. So this is a spider which mimics an ant. You can see that the forelegs have just come up just like the antenna of this ant. This is Polydactylus, it's a spiny ant. It mimics a spiny ant, lives along with it and eats the ant. Another threat to ants is the eucalyptus wasp. So this is a male wasp. What happens is the female wasp lays eggs on leaves. So when the ant walks, the eggs actually get attached to the worker's leg. So when the workers return to the colony, the eggs get transferred to the colony, the eggs hatch, and the larvae actually starts consuming the ant larvae and the eggs. So finally, they will pupate and come out. This is a eukaryotic wasp, which is also a parasite. So there are threats to the ant world as well. Now, coming to a brief history of ant studies in Kerala, like in all natural history field in India, the studies were initially started by the Westerners. So it started in the 1850s. The pioneers were, for example, Jordan, who was a medical doctor stationed in Madras. And then there was H.S. Ferguson, who was the first curator of the Natural History Museum in Trivandrum, who worked in Travancore. He worked everything from ants to cetaceans. And there are Rotten, Ingleby. These are all not notable names in ants. And there was the British Natural History Museum expert in South India in the 1930s, where they surveyed Nilambur, Tenmalai, Thambada, Nilgiris. Then there are occasional papers by Brown and, for example, he worked in Wayanad. So before 1972, a lot of specimens were being taken from India. The Wildlife Protection Act came into existence in 1972. Before that, a lot of specimens were taken out. Later, after that, there are a lot of studies coming up. In the last 20 years, a lot of interest have come up in ants, especially under the leadership of Dr. T.C. Narendran and group, and then the group by the Punjabi University. So there are certain interesting works coming up in this field lately. So the picture shows Harpagnatho salted, the jumping ant, which is ready to pounce on. It's a very interesting ant, jumping ant. Kind of ant that actually looks into your eyes. Coming to ant diversity in Kerala, according to Mushtaq Ali, Mushtaq Ali is our mentor. Sadly, he passed away last year. So he was a great encouragement to our work, especially to Manoj and me. He was a mentor. So he says, you are sitting on a gold mine, doctor. That is what he always said. So Kerala is a gold mine for ants. So the estimate, according to the published studies, is only about 278 or 280, but then our rough estimates stand at around 400 species. What we have observed is that for every 4 days you spend in field, you will get at least one new species to work. And a good work with the species will take at least 6 or 7 months. So this is the picture shows a series of ant workers of the Leptogenus, that is the army ant. It's a very common species in our forest. From the statistics, India has around 828 species, Kerala has 264 species. This is the split up of different subfamilies. It will be the slide I'll share later. We'll see that there are no endemic genus in India in ants. So it's a very interesting biogeographic question. And I would suggest the listeners to think about it and probably write an answer when the class finishes. So why are there no endemic species of ants in India, where there are endemic birds, butterflies, ornaments are there, but then there are no endemic ant genera in India? So if you see the state-wise split up, you'll see that a lot of species have come up from West Bengal, Sikkim, Himachal, and Kerala, 260. It's basically not because of the lesser diversity, but because of lesser studies in this field. So if you see the diverse genera, Campanotus probably tops it, around 26 species in Kerala, then followed by Polydactylus. There are a lot of other diverse species, for example, the Phenol, Tetramora, Chromatogaster. These are all multi-species gems, very common species. If you see ant diversity around your house, you'll see that at least 30, 40 species you can encounter. Of them, most of them are invasive species. If somebody asks you about ants around your home, you'll say all these species. For example, this first species is called Anaplolepis grasslippers. The second is, this is the yellow crazy ant. Second is a Monomorea vernois. In Malayalam, it's called Neyurum. The first species, Anaplolepis, is called Choran. Then we have the Kadiurum, that is called Solanopus geminata, and then Paratrachus. These are all invasive species, which is not generally our species. These are from other parts of the world which have invaded. There are at least 24 species which are not native. And whatever species you come across commonly are generally invasive. coming to basics of fan taxonomy, I'll keep this very simple because there are a lot of people who are lay public from this on this class. So I'll just keep it very simple. So basically, it has a mouth part on the mandible, then the head with the eyes. The eyes may be absent in some species. Then there's a thorax, which may divide into three pronotomies on the propodium. The main area of interest is the petiole, which connects the thorax to the abdomen or the gastrum. So the petiole has very high implications on the classification of ant families and subfamilies. Come to the morphology of the head. The head is a magnified view around four times, I guess. So you have the eyes, which is a compound eye, which has a lot of small eye lenses called ommatidia. And then there's an antenna with a number of funicles, then there's a mandible. There are a lot of hairs on it that are sculptures. Coming to the queen, queen has a large thorax. She has wings. This is the male. Doesn't have much of a mouth part. It's a rudimentary. It also has wings. Then the queen has extra eyes called ocelli. That is light receptors, ocelli. Coming to ant subfamilies in Kerala, classification might look a little hectic and boring, but then we'll just quickly go through them. So let's go to the next slide. So coming to the subfamily keys, it's basically based on the petiole. So if anybody wants to learn more about this, we can contact later. I'll just quickly go through this. The second group has two nodes on the petiole. That's how things go. Come to the first family or the door lines. Door lines are true army ants. These are generally subterranean ants that live in huge colonies. They move in small tunnels underground. They're practically never encountered in field. For example, if you read the fauna of British India, and especially that part dealing with doorless in Bingham, he'll be saying that doorless is a very common species. This is doorless. So it's a very common species, but then we never encountered. How we came to know about this was when we buried a chicken liver for 5 days underground. So we saw these ants at the fifth day. And there are certain other interesting ants like Aenictus. These are very common ants, but then you don't practically come across them because they are subterranean. Come to doorless. We have two species of this genus in India. We have found one species in Kerala. They are blind army ant. They move in subterranean tunnels. This is another kind of blind army ant called the Aenictus. Aenictus is a highly diverse genus in the state. There are a lot of species in Aenictus, probably new species also. You can see a blind group of Aenictus attacking a eyed feudal worker. The worker is a huge one, and the small blind things are attacking it, just like humans attacking an elephant. Now, this is the interesting ant called the clonal raider ant. So you might think that cloning was invented by humans, but not really. This ant can clone itself. She can produce lots of workers just like her by just cloning herself. So this is called Fusariaceae. It's a cloning ant. So it's a blind subterranean ant. The ant was placed on my laptop. That's why the aluminum frame of this iMac has come up. Now, this is another species called Eusphinctus. It's a high elevation species. Very interesting, looks like strawberry. Now, the second family, Ponarine. These are the ants that sting you. So if you see the bottom, the last picture shows a species called Diacama. This is the ant which we commonly call as Cutworm, which can sting you. There are a lot of species, around 16 genera. Pseudonepiona is a species which is almost a forming ant. If you catch the ant, it will start forming. It will make huge forms. This is an interesting ant called the Harpagonathus, or the jumping ant. It is seen in the high elevations of Western Ghats. The interesting part of this ant is that it is a very inquisitive ant. You can just look into your eye and move according to how you move. So this ant actually feeds on spiders and small crickets. So what it will do, it will inject this with a small neurotoxin, and the prey won't bite. It will just stay stupefied for months in the lab. This is called Aenictus, or the lesser trap jaw ant. Trap jaw because it has a trap jaw mechanism in its jaw. It moves with its jaws open, and there are two hairs in the front. So when it touches the prey, it will just shut close. It's in super speed. This is called the lesser trap jaw ant. It's a very common species at your home. This is another interesting species of the borderline group called the Sendromyrmex. It's a termitophile. This is a blind ant which is living inside termite mounds. So you can see small spikes on the legs. These spikes are used to wedge itself inside the termite galleries, and it will just happily sit there feeding on the termites. Diacama, Katturumbu in Malayalam, Diacama. It can give you a very nasty sting. You'll remember your school days when you used to use this to sting your colleagues. Ectomomyrmex is another interesting point. It's a very rare species. We have two species in Kerala. Very common species, Hypoponera. Very tiny ant, 2 to 3 millimeters maximum. This is the famous Leptogenus or the False Army Ant. If you go to any forest in Kerala, you will see huge swarms of this ant moving in a particular direction as an army. Otherwise, this is the only ant which can make some noise. If you disturb this ant, it will make a small rustling noise. It's very, very clear. You can clearly hear it if you go near it and disturb them. If you disturb them, you'll get a very nasty sting as well, which you'll remember for your life. This is the army ant. They will never make a permanent nest. The whole brood will move along with the army. They will march in one direction. They will eat all and whatever they find on this way. This is a Leptogenus worker guarding the army. This is a colony. You can see the pupal cases. Another interesting pond is a Mesopanera. Mesopanera is a very common species in our forest. Odontomachus. Odontomachus is the greater trapjaw ant. This is one of the ants which has a bigger trapjaw mechanism and one of the fastest movements in the insect world, the trap mechanism. You can see the wide open jaws, and there are two hairs, a few hairs in it, and the ant comes across a prey, it just shuts close. This is a close up of the head part of the species, greater trapjaw ant. This is Odontoponera. This species has been seen in Himalayas, and then we have a record from Siren Valley and High Elevation Zone estimates. Panditari is another species of ant which didn't have a Malayalam name, so we called it Urulan Urumbu. There is no features on it to describe anything, so it is just rounded. Ponera is a rare species. There are no published records of this species from Kerala, I guess. This is one of the interesting species came across in Agastya village. When you want to give common names to ant, this is one ant which you can easily name as the strawberry ant. So when you write a common book, people will ask for common names of ants. There are a lot of ants which doesn't have common names. So if you look at common names of ants, there are very few species, for maybe 10 or 15 species, which has common names in vernacular languages. So and even in English, if you want to explain to people, you need common names. So this is one of the ants, when we ask kids about how to name them, one kid happily said, you can call it strawberry ant, which is really an apt name for this species. Leptogenus, we have three species of Leptogenus in Kerala. It's another subfamily called Ictiotomidae. Let me give a very interesting family called Amblyoponidae or the Dracula ants. These ants are interesting in the sense they behave like Dracula. So in lean period, when there is no food, what happens is that the worker will make a small incision in the on the larva or the pupa and then drinks the blood of the brood. So, and they survive the lean period. But then the brood is not harmed. So this is why they are known as the Dracula ant. They also feed on centipedes. And they just suck out the juices from them, and hence aptly called the Dracula. You can see the mouth part with these hook-like teeth. This is the Dracula ant. We have two or three species. One on the bottom is the Stigmatoma minutum. It's a very small ant. So this is a colony of Stigmatoma minutum, which is hunting a centipede. This is another species called Stigmatoma belli or the Bell's Dracula ant, which is feeding on a big species of centipede. Coming to Myrmecinae, which are the common ants. If you look at your ants around your home, these are the most numerous which you'll find. And it is represented by 25 genera. Around 114 species are there in Kerala. They are generally terrestrial arboreal. So interesting species we'll discuss. One is Caribara. Caribara is a very common species around your house. They live in huge colonies. This guy particularly has two horns on his head, probably Caribara horny. Then Catalocus is an interesting group of ants. If you handle this ant, it will just turn into a ball. In Malayalam, we named it as Pandurum because of this particular phenomenon. If you handle it, it will turn into a ball. And after that, sometime it will just go off. So this is called Catalogus. It resembles an armored vehicle, a military vehicle-like appearance. It's an interesting group of ants. This is the Chromatogaster ant. It's interesting that you can see the abdomen. If it wants to sting you, it will just bend the abdomen over the thorax and then sting you. That is the way it stings. It's called Chromatogaster. And you might have heard about a particular woodpecker called Rufous woodpecker, which breeds inside nest of Chromatogaster ants. These ants are also interesting in the fact that they attend to a lot of lacerate caterpillars, especially Spindasis group. Spindasis is the silver lines. A lot of silver line caterpillars are fed by Chromatogaster ants. These are very interesting that the association is very specific. Meranoplus, the apt name in Malayalam is Mudiyurum because of the long hairs it has. Another species, Meranoplus periarensis, was described in 2014 by Bharati and Lakhbar from Punjab University from Periyar. Very interesting group, it has long spines and hairs on the body, Meranoplus. Messer is the harvester ant, which I told you about. There are a lot of interesting castes in this, which have different jobs to do in the colony. This is monomorian, Malayalathil neyyurumbu, neyyurumbu. Very common species inside your house. This is probably monomorian pharmaceus, an invasive species from Africa. Coming to Myrmeceria. So while we are giving common names in our book, the apt name for this species came as fingerprint ant, because you can see the pattern on the thorax and head. It resembles a human fingerprint. So this we have two species from Kerala, Myrmeceria urbani and Myrmeceria vidae. Very interesting group. It's pretty common around the lower to mid elevations of Western Ghats. In 2017, we discovered a new species of ant from a Periyar tiger reserve. It's from a genus called Taranomyrmex. Taranomyrmex is an interesting genus which is seen in Sri Lanka and Malaysia. One species was also described from Ponmudi. And then this we found in Periyar. We described in 2017 in a paper in Zoo Taxa. We named it after our mentor, Dr. Mushtaq Ali, as Taranomyrmex Ali. Myrmeceria in Malayalam is the Koonan Urumbu. You might have heard about the Koonan Urumbu, but this is the first time probably you are seeing it. Koonan Urumbu in Padagal, that is, there is a song after it. So this is the Koonan Urumbu because of the hunchback appearance. It keeps the abdomen curved inside the, under the thorax. And this guy has huge colonies, which is seen around the bases of trees. And they just dig and put out all the soil until the tree just withers away. This is Myrmeceria or the Koonan Urumbu, hunchback ant. This is Paratopila, one species we found. At least two are there in this district. Paratopila ceylonica, probably. This is a group of interesting ants known as Phaedon. They feed on a lot of stuff. During our field, what we do is we accidentally drop things. For example, we dropped a piece of ledu, and then when we came back, we saw this ant. These are all different sized ants, but then they are all same species. This is a soldier. This is a big one. This is a major worker. These are the minor workers. The major workers just lie inside the colonies, and they're summoned by the minor workers when they find a huge chunk of food so that they can just cut it off. Because these guys cannot cut it. These are called in and they cut it off, and these guys carry it away to the colony. So it's a division of labor. This is an interesting genus called Rhophala mastix, which is seen inside living trees, for example, mango trees. Inside the bark, you'll find them. Very interesting species, very tiny, 2 to 3 millimeters only, Rhophala mastix. This is the Solanopsis, or the, in Malayalam you call it as the Kadiyurum, or the red fire ant. It's an invasive species from South America, I guess, and they can give you a nasty bite. This is a very tiny ant called Strumigena, which also has a trap jaw mechanism. You can see the trap jaw, and it feeds on a particular kind of insect called the columbon or the springtail. So this is a picture of a Strumigena feeding on a springtail. This ant has an interesting kind of behavior. If you handle them, they'll just feed death. And then after some time, you just walk away. It's very tiny, just 1 or 1.5 millimeters of size. Very tiny ant. You can see a colony here. Tetramorium is a common genus. Then come to the next subfamily, Dolichodera. These are generally weaver ants, and they have a particular kind of order. Some of the ants are called order ants. For example, you can see Tapinama. It's a ghost ant. This is a Technema. These are all common ants. This is another weaver ant called Dolichodera. Tapinama is a ghost ant. Ghost ant. This is Technomyrmex. Coming to an interesting family called Proseratinae. You can see that in this particular ant, the abdomen is curved. And this ant, actually what it does is, it is a brood predator. It feeds on the brood of other insects and arachnids, for example, spiderex. And it just happily takes out the egg, hides it, and then runs away. This is called Discotheria. Another subfamily is Leptanellae. This ant is really tiny. It is probably as thin as your hair. So when you take them from field, if your breath happens to fall on them, they'll just fly away. They are so tiny. The big ant in the frame is the queen, and the others are the workers. You can see the larvae and the pupae as well. We found them in Periyar. So at least 2 or 3 species are seen in Kerala. This is really tiny, one of the smallest ants you can encounter, around 1 millimeter or 1.5 millimeter of the size. And the thickness just comes maybe slightly larger than your hair. The other missing family is the Pseudomyrmecinae. These are otherwise known as the leaf border ants. Leaf border, because they are constantly seen running around the border of leaves on the trees and shrubs. Generally, they resemble a Harley Davidson bike, the shine and the way they are oriented. They can give you a nasty sting if you handle them. They'll produce a particular kind of order. There are 6 species in a single genus. This is Tetraponera nigra. This is Tetraponera rufa nigra. You might have encountered a small spider, which is also having the similar color and structure and movement as this ant. This is called Tetraponera rufonigra, a very common species which can give you a very nasty sting. Coming to other family, Formicin, it is also a very common group. There are about 68 species in this. And generally, the ants you see around your home are either Myrmecine ants or Formicine ants. They do not have a stinging apparatus, but then they have a strong acid spraying mechanism. This is a very interesting ant called Acropega. On a first look, you might think that it's a termite. Actually, they also live like termites underground. So this picture was taken in Bangalore. This Acropega acutiventris. So the evil in the society called dowry, right? So actually, dowry was not invented by humans. It was discovered by this ant. This ant is otherwise known as the dowry ant. You can see an Acropega queen with a dowry between her mandibles. The story goes like this. So this ant actually lives underground, and the colonies are connected or clustered around particular trees which harbor a root parasite known as Coenococcus undendale, which is this particular aphid, Coenococcus undendale. So the colony of the ants will be rearing this Coenococcus on the roots of certain trees. As the colony matures and it's time to divide, the gynes will actually fight among themselves to get the largest gravid Coenococcus. Only those females or the queens or gynes with these larger Coenococcus will be mated by males. So that is how dowry evolved in the ant society, and we have parallelisms in the human society. This is called the dowry ant. The female will go with the large, which goes with the largest aphid, will get the males. This is Anaplolepis, or commonly known as the yellow crazy ant, or Chonanurumbu in Malayalam. Very common species, and it is invasive. So in forests, if you see this ant, there is no need to look for other ants because it is so invasive. They'll be removing all the native ant species from the region. So they will not sting, but they'll produce strong formic acid, which they can spray. If you see them, farmers are use this species to dry out weaver ants. This is Camponotus. In Malayalam, people call it Katurumbu, but this Katurumbu does not sting you. Another species of Camponotus, very common. This is probably from the irritants group. Lepisiota is another interesting ant, which you see in grasslands and in forests. Another interesting ant is Myrmotras. Myrmotras, they didn't have a Malayalam name. And looking at the mandibles, it looked like the old swords of mythological heroes. We named it as the Valurumbu. Val for this one. You can see that the ant is colored brown and it has a huge eyes on the head. So these are the huge eyes. That means it's a predator. We have four or five species in Kerala. This is Indicum. This is Brachygnathum. This is one of the queens attending the larva. The interesting part of this ant is that the mandibles can open up to 270 degrees. And then it also has a trap jaw mechanism. 270 degrees is something like a V on the head. This is a common species, Nyland area. They have seen inside homes and even cars. Oikophila is a very common species, the weaver ant. So you have seen that weaver ants make nests in trees. These are actually secretions from the larvae, not the adult. Paratrachina is one of the ants which has some mythology associated with it. People call it a lot of names like Ganesha, Urumbu, and all that. And they think that when they come inside house, they'll get money. This is actually an invasive species, and this is probably from Southeast Asia, Paratrachina, Carinjon. Another interesting group, biogeographically as well as evolutionarily, is the Polyrachis group. Polyrachis is the spiny ant. These ants have spines on the vulnerable part of the body, for example, the thorax and the part connecting the abdomen. So these are the vulnerable parts, and they have spines. This is Polyrachis. Malayalathil, we call it Mullurumbu. This is a species called Aculeata, Polyrachis aculeata. This Polyrachis bingami. See the way the hook is gone, Polyrachis bingami. The interesting part of this group is that if you handle the ant will have a spray, which will be very interesting. So this particular ant will give you a spray which resembles vinegar. The odor resembles vinegar. This is Polyrachis exercita. This guy will spray you with a chemical which resembles jasmine, the odor of jasmine. This is Polyrachis hippomenus ceylonensis. This is Polyrachis thrinax, very common species in your gardens. Polarakis rotoni, thought to be a very rare species, but then they are very common in our forest. Polarakis grasula, very interesting species, very beautiful species, black and red. They all have interesting order in their sprays. This is Polarakis rastrellata, looks like a car. This is Polarakis tibialis. And this is Polarakis pancetta Fergusoni. So this ant was actually probably taken by Ferguson from Travancore, and it was described. This Ferguson's spiny ant. So this is doing prophylaxis, that is a mouth-to-mouth transfer of the food. Polarakis sisa, which has an incised look, a cut on the thorax, is called Polarakis sisa. These are all common ants in the forest, and some of them are also found on our homesteads. This is Polarakis illudator, the golden spiny ant, Suvarna mullurumbu in Malayalam, very common species in the forest. If you go to any lower evergreen forest in Kerala, you'll find this ant, very beautiful species. Coming to the lacunae and knowledge gaps in ant studies in Kerala, there has not been any systematic surveys on ants. We have done surveys on birds and butterflies and similar groups, but then there have not been any systematic surveys on ants in Kerala. Field methodology also, considering their diverse habitats, it has not been standardized. We do have good access to photographs of especially types and paratypes of species described from India by the Westerners. But then the interesting stuff is that we do not have much access to species described later by Indian workers. And the species descriptions are very vague and subjective. That is the one part we have to keep in mind. There are a lack of good books and references, though there are a few books which can actually prime you to the field, but there are a lack of good books and references. There are no actual good field books as well. There are no awareness programs and revisions of certain groups that are just replicas of what Bingham has done in 1903. A lot of scope of work is there, for example, in chemical taxonomy, toxicology, molecular work. So we need to revive pure taxonomy. Ant is a good example where you can work on pure taxonomy, initial studies on ant ecology. I don't think there is any reference to any ant in any in school children's academics. So these are things which we can actually keep in mind. So there should be an awareness creation among the lay public, as well as the scientists and our students, especially why we should be studying ants. And as sir said initially, there is the indicator species and the lag time. People who are interested to read further on ants, you can refer to the following websites. Antweb.org, which is a collection of a lot of type specimens, good quality images, and scientific data on ants of the world. You can have a lot of pictures from Kerala as well. Then there's antwiki.com, which is a good resource for people who are working on ants. Then AntCat and AntMaps. In Facebook, there are a lot of groups on ants, for example, Ants of India, Ants of Kerala, Ants of Western Ghats. There are a few books in India which you can refer. Urumbugal is a small book by us, published by the State Language Institute, but then it just has 30, 40 species. And then On Trail with Ants is a book which actually triggered our interest in ants. It's by Ajay Narendra and Sunil Kumar. It's a good book, but not about taxonomy is there, but then it's a handbook. It's a good a beginner's guide to ants of South India. For the primed, I would probably suggest to go and read Bingham 1903, the Fauna of British India series. And then there are a lot of other books concerning specific genus and revisions and stuff. Come to TNHS, we are a group of individuals. We were in the field since maybe last 20 years. We registered in 2010. We are registered in Trivandrum, and we do a lot of work in the forests of Kerala, as I explained. The main purpose of our work is publications and research papers and doing conservation. In 2015, we established what is known as a TARG. It's a TNHS and research group. So we actually do have a collection permit in Kerala, and we are doing scientific work describing species, ecology, and all this stuff. So this is one of the taxonomic workshops which I have done in Kerala University. This is Dr. Mushtaq Ali training the students. It's a very interesting class. A lot of people, I think some of them are even attending the class today. So this was a turning point in a lot of people's mind. So he actually passed away last year. So he's our mentor. So this is a few pictures from our field where we work. Unlike other group of taxa like birds and butterflies, ants require a lot of labor. You have to sit down and do work in field, and you have to get soil. So this is our contact. If anybody has any queries on Amazon stuff, you can contact us on our email, Manoj and me, or then you can have the group email as well. So this is one of the pictures from the field where we found out the Leptonella, that tiny ant from Periyar. Thank you.
Thank you, Kalesh.
Thank you.
Now, the time for question and session, Q&A. You can open the Q&A session, Kalesh. You can see the questions.
Sir, I am unable to access it. Can somebody read it out for me?
Yeah, sure.
The first
question is from Smita Anand. Okay. I think she asked for an English book on Indian ants.
So I'll just quickly, are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, sure.
So these are, if you go for books, one book I would suggest is the On Trail with Ants by Ajay Narendra. I don't know if the book is still in print, but then this is a good book to start with. And then you go to Fauna of British India, which is available on free for free download on archives.org. Bingham 1903, Hymenoptera. This is a very serious kind of taxonomic work in 1903. After that, nothing solid had come out. So better to start with On Trail with Ants, then followed by reading Bingham. And then for specific groups, you go to AntWeb or AntCat, AntWeb or AntWiki, and learn more about it. That would be the best option.
And second question, why different species of ants are not sharing food together? We normally noticed a single species in the sugar jar.
Okay, the answer is very simple. The ants, they are constantly at war with their own kind as well as other colonies. Okay. Even with the same species colonies, they are constantly at war. So it basically, you'll think that these are male cages, but they are not like that. It's a dynamic equilibrium happening in the forest as well. So there are territories which these colonies protect, and then they expand and then decrease in size, and they are just constantly at war. So they don't actually interact and share food. There are but certain species like Wollenhovia, which have parasitic colonies along with them. There are certain groups of genus where there are two or three ants living together as well. It's also there. But then there are, generally they fight among themselves. It's just they don't actually share with other species or other colonies.
And next question from Rajesh Shagar. Are termites or ants?
No, termites are different group. They are different group. They are not ants.
And from Anu, why Kerala has less number of ant studies according to you?
Basically that people have not got themselves interested into ants. But then there is a recent change in the trend. The recent increase in Facebook and social media and all the stuff and digital photography, they have made a revolutionary change. People are getting interested. So now at least we have webinars like this where people can get primed. So now things will be changing.
From Aniket Kashyap, what are some major challenges in identification of species and how modern taxonomists are overcoming them? Already hinted, I think.
So basically, we in the present scenario, we are all going by morpho taxonomy. The second option is to go for a genetic work and then chemical taxonomy. But generally, we all stick on to morpho taxonomy based on electron microscopic images and micro CT and all this stuff.
From Ritin, please suggest good identification keys for ants.
The best option is to refer Bingham 1903, and then for the recent updates, you can go in for keys in antwiki.com, where they have keys for every group for every geographical region on Earth.
From Deepthi, how the blind ants interact with their surroundings?
You might have seen that all the blind ants have huge antennae. They interact using the antennae and the chemical signals.
And why ants are dying after they bite humans?
They don't generally die unless you... like bees, they don't die. Generally, they die because you squish them. Please send the PDF file of ants on Agora WhatsApp. PDF file on ants, I don't know what PDF file is asking, but if you can send me an email, I can definitely respond.
From Sanjayan, we have named the species as the state bird. State butterfly, etc. Whether ant studies have reached a level so as to declare an ant species as the state ant. Any state in India has named a species as their state ant.
actually, ant studies in India has been very rather frugal. So we don't even have state-wise checklists, which are extensive. But then there are certain ants which actually merit mentioning. For example, if you see IUCN Red List, no ants are on it. If you see state list, there are no ants on it. So probably I would suggest this Harpagnatho saltator as the state ant for Kerala. Very interesting ant.
Then from Anu, how the ant sense?
Explained.
Then suggest some online sources for ants.
Yeah, I can see the slide, antweb.org and wiki.com. These are the two interesting sites, antweb and antwiki.
Then how many types of ants are dangerous?
Actually, there are not much studies on how dangerous these ants are. But then there are certain ants, for example, your leptogynous and all ponarine, which can give you a nasty sting. And if people are interested in the neurotoxins, they can probably study it, because the prey they take, they don't putrefy. They just lie there stupefied for months in the lair. We have dissected colonies of Harpagnatho. We found lots of crickets and spiders, which are just stupefied and just lying there in semi-sleep. They never die. They are just fresh for their brood. So it's a very interesting thing to study. Neurotoxins of ants.
And from Shine Raj, please answer. Then what are the causes what caused the lack of endemism of ants in India?
So that was a question I asked you. That was a homework. And then people are asking me that.